Imamo sjajno gosta večeras, legenda svjetske muzike Edi Grant, za 5 sekundi ovde.
I zašto nikad mene ne poslušate kada uradim ovako, nego uvek čekate njega? To mene zanima. A nisam autoritet, šta? Treba pustim kosu. Prestanem se kupam, šta? Dobro. Vreme je za našeg večerašnjeg gosta. Sa nama je čovjek koji je jako važan ljudima iz moje generacije, nekim malo starijim, ali nažalost malo manje ovim mlađim. I zbog toga je večera sa nama da vam ga preporučimo kao obaveznu muzičku lektiru. Edi Grant! It is like, you know, it's a special show for me, you know? I mean, when you bring the big people from your childhood, you always feel like a bit, you know.
We were children together.
Oh, yeah, I forgot, sorry. It's my mistake. It's my mistake. Welcome to my show.
Thank you very much.
It's very nice to have you in Belgrade and to have you at my show. You don't have a concert or anything? You just came to visit some friends?
Just came to visit a very good friend of mine for about 40 years or so. And here I am.
Yeah, okay, cool. Thank you. I mean, we are friends for 40 years or something, you know, so it's... No, it's
bad boy. Yeah.
Okay. So how do you feel here? I mean, you always had friendly feelings to Belgrade and to Serbia, Serbian people.
I started coming here when I was quite young. It's been a long time.
You're still young.
Thank you very much. It's very good. Very good. I started coming here when I was young. And now that I am a little older, I'm still coming here. So there must be something here that is special to me, because I have the whole world to go to.
Yes,
you understand?
Yeah, I understand.
So when you see me in Belgrade, you know that there is something special
here
for me.
Yeah.
That's good.
Okay, cool. That's nice to hear. That's nice to hear. I do have some information that Gibanica might be that something that brings you to Belgrade. Someone told me, maybe it's not true. You know?
Someone told you about Gibanica.
Yeah.
You can't trust your friends now. I had Gibanica yesterday. 1, 2, 3, 4, I think 6 pieces.
Whoa, nice.
I slept very well last night.
Yeah. You know, I had 2 pieces 2 months ago, and look at my belly. You know, it's unbelievable.
I'm starting to get worried. That's why I'm wearing the jacket.
Yeah, just, I'll be careful about the buttons. You know, it might get me in my eye. You know,
it's starting,
I don't want that to happen.
No, it's starting to happen to me.
Okay. Anyhow, it is obviously that Belgrade and Serbs also have very nice feelings to you. And the entire career was magnificent, and it still is. And I wanted to speak with you a little bit about your career and how did you start to do the music. And we'll see some clips from the past, not so long ago. You look at the clips almost the same like now.
Liar.
Yeah. You know, they pay me to lie, famous people in this show, you know.
No, at least you're honest, liar.
Let's start now, you know, like, yeah, you come from Guyana, yeah, I'm
Guyana, it's in South America. That's,
yeah, right. There was a lot of children in the family.
A lot of children.
9?
Well, there were 5 inside.
Yeah, and 4 of them always outside. Yeah.
You understand.
Yeah, I understand.
You may come from Guyana too.
No, we also lived in a small space, a lot of members of the family, so half of us needs to be outside all the time.
That's correct.
We had shifts, you know, so I was outside from 5 to 9, and then my brother goes out. And,
I understand.
Yeah, and when the grandpa goes out, he never comes back, you know.
Granddad was very busy.
It was the Alzheimer's.
Yes, yeah,
okay. And how the first interest for the music came to you?
My dad was a trumpet player.
Oh.
As was I when I first started playing music. My dad played in one of the famous bands in Guyana. And he would come home after playing on a show somewhere. And he'd go to sleep at 3 o'clock in the morning. I would wake up at about 8 o'clock in the morning and decide to take the trumpet out from underneath the bed and
wake up everybody, you know?
Yes. So after I'd done that a few times, my dad says, you know what? I think I better teach you to play so that it would be at least a little more pleasant for me to wake up to. And so he taught me.
And how old were you when you started to learn the trumpet?
Properly. 12 years old.
12 years old?
Yeah.
Okay.
The other years, I was just messing about.
Just messing about.
Yes.
And do you know that we have a great trumpets here in Serbia? In Guča, there is a big festival with trumpets?
No, I don't.
Oh, they make miracles. I think Radomir should bring you there next time. It's August. Yeah, and it's beautiful. And the ladies go naked, you know, because the trumpet, that's what...
I'm going.
Yeah. I'm telling you, I won't lie to you, you know? And did you play trumpet ever after?
I played trumpet from 12 years old to when I started playing guitar with my school orchestra, and we had a little jazz band at the school, and so when we jazz up the hymns and so on, yeah.
You did. And do you play it today?
No.
No.
From the day I picked up the guitar.
Guitar.
Trumpet
and
was...
When was that day?
I went to London in 1960, and by 1964, I had made a guitar. I made my first guitar.
By yourself?
Yes. Well, with the help of my teacher, because it started to become very fashionable. The early 60s was not so fashionable for guitars. It was jazz and traditional jazz and that sort of thing. So the jazz bands like Kenny Ball, Acca Bilk, these people were very popular in the early part of the 60s. As it came to the middle of the 60s, the guitars started taking over. The Beatles and the Rolling Stones and people like this. And so I really wanted, being a musician now, I really wanted to be in with the boys.
With the boys, yeah. Yes. So that's how it started.
And with the girls, maybe.
Of course, yeah.
Yes.
Did it happen a few times?
No. I wasn't that good.
You wasn't that good,
no.
Yeah. You know, my assistant Bunny, you know, the guy here in the white trousers?
Which one is that?
Yeah, Mahri Čoveku Da Zna Ko Si.
Show yourself.
This one, yeah, it's him, you know.
Hi, Bunny.
Yeah. You know, he's almost 40. He's almost 40, and he adores rock and roll. And he has a big wish to meet a woman sometimes in his life, you know.
Oh.
Yeah. So there is hope for him, yeah?
There is a little hope for you. Not much.
Yeah.
You have to get a guitar.
Yeah. So this is the last train, you know.
And then
so
you have to be like Chuck Berry, you know.
I want to ask you about London, because the London was really, and maybe it's even today, but today it's very hard to decide. But in 60s and 70s, definitely the music center of the world. And we can say that the rock and roll was there. If you see the Rolling Stones and Beatles are not from London, but they're from Britain. But the South London, where you were, brought the reggae and ska, which
I was North London.
North London.
You're opposite to me tonight. Why are you
doing
this?
I'm mixing North and South. I'm sorry.
Okay.
But I'll explain you later why.
Oh, I understand.
I have an explanation for
that. I'm sure you have explanations for everything. Is your wife here tonight?
No, she left me a long time ago. She's not coming to my shows anymore. It's boring to her. But I have her on the picture, you see? She was very pretty.
Well, that,
I mean, she's still pretty, but she's not mine anymore.
It's all right.
Which makes her a bit uglier, you know.
Oh, I see. Okay. Don't look at me. She's
no,
not
I'm
mine.
Joking. It's okay. It's okay. Tell me, the first band that you were playing in was Equals, yeah?
Absolutely.
And there are a lot of specifics about this band. It was actually the first time that some successful band has a mixture of black and white people. That it was kind of not so usual in that time.
That's true. We had in London, in England, only a couple of years before, massive race riots in the streets and what have you. So this was not on the cards at all. They had black artists who had sold records and been successful before, but never a mixture of these young people.
Yeah.
And maybe it was God's will to keep things quiet in England for a while, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That he brought us together and we jammed and did what other young musicians did, and eventually you had a band that was called The Equals. And the name seemed to sound right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we played the music of James Brown, Otis Redding, Chuck Berry, Wilson Pickett, all of these people. And we also played the music of the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, who was playing Chuck Berry. And eventually I started to write.
But did you, as every guitar player, did you like Hendrix, or did you find him as your idol or something like that?
I was Hendrix's contemporary. You seem to forget. I am a little old, you know. Jimi Hendrix actually came to London when we were in full flow. The Equals were in full flow. If you ever look back on the early Equals shows, you would see me playing and doing all the guitar tricks. They've been as old as time.
Yeah, let's see if you agree. Like Schoberg, we have something with the Equals. So
yes.
Let's see, and then we'll continue, because I think I have that moment. You know?
Okay.
This is you, yeah?
That's correct.
Something. Is this this was 1967, 68, or
That would have been probably 67.
67? So,
or 67 or 68.
So you probably did this with the guitar before Hendrix.
Well, we all listen. There were many guys doing this. T-Bone Walker. There were many guys in America who were playing like this.
Yeah.
Some of us did more than the other, but this is not to take away from the greatness of Jimmy as a guitarist,
course, yeah.
You know. I mean, he did what he did, we did what we did, and we all made a little money, and we're happy.
How did you decide about the suit? Because I like it a lot, you know. It's...
Well... He's a bad boy.
I mean, it's kind of nice, you know?
Well, since you started picking on my suit, let me tell you the truth about my suit.
Yeah, please.
When I started dressing like that, all the bands in England were wearing decent suits,
ties,
and so on and so forth. In the history of the music business, as they write it in England, this is never mentioned. There is one of the Equals, a friend of mine, who always says to me, Ed, why don't they ever talk about what we did in the history of the music business? They always say it was the Bay City Rollers that had the first trousers that were short with boots. They always say that it was Dave D, Dozy, Beaky, Mick and Titch who wore the first bright colors. When we were wearing those things, those guys were wearing denims and corduroys, and you know, they looked like bank managers.
So what do you think? Why nobody speaks about that?
If I had to be frank, which I'm not going to be frank here because I'm like you, I tell lies as well, you know?
Okay, I know.
Okay,
it's
but if
business.
I had to tell the truth, I would say that it is not for England. You know, England does not want that to represent England. And it's unfortunate because today it does represent England. Yeah. You go to the Olympics, you see lots of black kids running with white kids. You go to the football matches, you see lots of black kids running with white kids. I don't know. But history will be put right.
Yes.
Definitely put right.
Sooner or later.
Sooner or later.
And one more question I have for you, because I now have a dilemma. Are you naturally blonde, or it was just for this...
I don't know.
But it's a nice haircut. Because I'm telling this with a big respect, because in that time, this was very brave, and it was
Let me also tell you about that. The guy who used to be the Beatles press agent met me one day in Denmark Street, which is the music street in London. And we were talking, and I heard him say something about black footballers. He says black footballers don't have bottle. Well, in England, or in London certainly, bottle means he doesn't have balls, or,
you know. Yeah, of course, yeah, we know.
Right. So I stopped and I said, hey, what did you say? He says, they don't. They don't go in hard. They don't know the meaning of the word bottle. And I said, nah, that's not true. It's another reason that they're not playing for England. So he said, well, for example, you, Eddie Grant, you wouldn't make your hair white. I mean, white people would not like you. Black people would not like you. You'd be out like South. And I said, wait there. I'll see you later on. And I went down the road, went to a barber's, and I asked the barber, listen, do you know how to make my hair white? And there was about, I don't know, 15 guys in the room, and they all started laughing. I said, I'm serious. He says, well, come back later. I've got this stuff, and I'll try it on you. Well, you could see the result.
Yeah?
When that was done, I couldn't face myself. I looked in the mirror, and I thought, Jesus. And I was about to get married only a few months down the road. I thought, oh, my wife, oh, no.
Might change her mind.
She might change her mind. But eventually, I had to go back and do my eyelashes as well.
So, okay, but besides the impact that Equals had on the music world, and you decided in some moment to start with your solo career, which was even more successful, probably. And how it happened and why? How did you bring this decision? How it happens to the people that are the part of the band?
In 1971, on December the 1st, no, January the 1st, 1971, I had a heart problem. I was 23 years old. And this was, you can imagine, this was a massive, massive shock to me. And it changed my life. I had to go into hospital, spent some weeks there. And the doctors were really quite sure that I would never do the things that I do today.
Yeah.
Then, so in fact, I was like becoming an old man at 23. Oh, to go to the bathroom was, I take forever, you know. But my grandmother, who I went to back in Guyana, was able to feed me on herbs and good food and look after me and so on. And during that period of time, I told the guys who were on the a different management to me by then, that I don't think that I would be able to continue doing that hard stuff that I used to do. Why don't they let me just write for them and produce the music as I was before? And their manager said no. And then I was in deep trouble, because now I didn't have anything to do, and I thought, well, I should really try and see if I can make this thing happen for myself on my own. And basically, in a nutshell, that's it.
Yeah, but is it true that I have this information, and maybe it's not true, so you will correct me, that actually the first solo album that you did was first published in the former Yugoslavia in 1980. Before then, it started in Europe.
That is correct, which is why myself and Radomir Krikic are such great friends,
yeah.
Because it started a long time ago. No one wanted to hear me doing this new stuff. They wanted me to continue making the Equals and even further than the Equals. That was in Europe. In places like Trinidad, they gave me a chance. They gave me a chance that really saved my life as an artist. And with that, then I went to Argentina, and they loved me there, and they saved my life again. With that success, now I became a little braver,
yeah.
And started to stretch out and do my music. And I came then to Europe, who would not have me, and you had me, and here I am today. Thank you very much.
It was an honor for us, and it is today, too.
The thing that you must understand is that all of this movement that was going on was happening on my little record company, Ice Records, not on a major company or anything yeah. like this. So when Radomir met me, I was in a little room with my wife and my brother and a couple of children trying to make a record company.
Yeah.
And so when he said, look, I can take this to Yugoslavia as it was then, you know, and maybe we can try something.
Did you know anything about Yugoslavia at that moment?
I only knew President Tito.
Yeah, of course.
Who was a very good friend of my president in Guyana. And they had this non-aligned movement which was very good for.
Yeah.
So this is all that I knew about Yugoslavia. And Radomir and I then had this relationship as a friend, as a record company boss, and so on and so forth. And it grew and blossomed, as did the music. And the rest of the world followed.
Yeah. Can I now... Hvala, Bane. Hvala. We did let's say the 80s was colored with your music. You were a great, great star in a period of 10 years, 11 years, let's say, at the top of the world. And we did some short clips. We combined two songs together. It's very short, 1 minute. Maybe you won't like it because you're a musician. But since I do not know anything about the music, to me, it's nice.
That's the first honest thing you've said all night.
Yes. Yes. And then we'll speak a little bit about making the songs and okay. about those great hits.
Thank you.
So we combined here two different songs completely. And we have this song from the movie that everybody watched, and it's something like commercial that musicians do. And we have a politically engaged song, which is very important in the 80s, and it's important even today, because it's speaking about a big problem at that time, like apartheid in the South Africa. And you did serious lines, serious text, with very funny music, you know, like that people will maybe swallow this easier. You know?
Yes. You've said the right word, swallow. So much about social commentary. People talk about political, but it's social commentary. It's writing about people. It's writing about people's lives, their circumstances, their children's lives, and maybe children's lives for centuries to come. That's what a song like that is. I thought maybe that when apartheid was over, the song would be over. But it just shows you that people and things, how they relate over time, there is a sort of consistency that a bad guy is a bad guy is a bad guy, and a good guy is a good guy is a good guy. Nelson Mandela, and I must say it while I'm here, is right now fighting for his life.
For his life.
He is 95 years old. They don't make men like that. And I knew that then. Nobody else seemed to care. I went into the studio one night after having seen a terrible videotape of what was going on in South Africa. And it made me cry. I mean, real tears. My wife, who was out to get me a cup of chocolate, when she came back and she saw me, I was doing this, you know, trying to make out, you know, like us guys do.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. And she says, what's that? I said, don't say anything. I'm going back into the studio. I didn't have an idea to write anything, but within 20 yards of my door, my studio is about 50 yards away, this thing kept on pounding me in the head. Give me hope, Joanna. Give me hope, Joanna. Give me hope. And I said, what the hell is Joanna? And why give me hope? You know? But by the time I got to the studio door, I recognized what's happening. I ran inside. I told the engineer, take off the tape, take off the tape. Put on another tape and start. Boom, boom, boom. And I started to play this. And that is what happened. At the end of it, I have a song that I could hardly understand. And I'm saying to myself, what am I going to do with this? Who the hell is going to play this? My brother said the same thing to me. He said, Eddie, if you put this out, you're finished. Thanks. Thanks. Thanks for making me not finish.
Yeah. But tell me now, then you're bringing the decision to put the song out.
Yes.
What were the first impressions when the song started to play all around the world?
First of all, it played in England. You know, I hadn't had a couple of hits for a little while. And then I turn up with this thing and nobody wanted it.
Yeah,
no record company wanted to touch it, as my brother said. And so now I had to go into my pocket again, go back to my little Ice Records and start by myself again. And then every record company in the world wanted it.
To take it.
To take it, that's right. Even the government started to be a little bit more relaxed with me with regard to playing the song and stuff like this. And so, you know, sometimes God smiles on you. And certainly I have to say that in my life, God has smiled on me. He's also smiled on South Africa because Nelson Mandela came out. Nelson Mandela stopped a war from happening. We don't know of what proportions. And I have to say tonight on this program, thank you to Nelson Mandela for not making that war happen in my lifetime. Yeah. And I think the whole world thanks him for that.
That was It is like, you know, it's an old guy, but his daughter said something in the past few days. She said that my father will maybe go, but he will never leave.
It's very strange that you should say that, granddaughter. She's now 6 months old. And I talked to her, and she talks back to me. You know how granddaughters talk. Goo, 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 ga, 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 ga. And so, but I talked to her real positive talk, like a man to a woman. And I think that she understands. And one day I said to her, I says, you know, they can kill me, but they can never stop me. And I think that those are the words of Nelson Mandela. It doesn't matter.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. And one more interesting thing about this song, you probably don't know that, but in many weddings in Serbia they play this song, and then everybody goes like a train to the room, you know, because I think that this proves that the music in this song is also very good, not only the lines, and no matter that it's politically engaged, you know, it's a good song, it's a perfect song.
Well, it's certainly been played a lot all over the world at different times. Even in South Africa, white people love it. Yeah. You know, I mean, really, really. I've been there and I've seen it, and they've told me, thank you, Eddie, for having written this song for us. And, you know, people, the Germans, when in last World Cup, they had this song about their coach, you know? So yeah. It transcends the political arena.
Yes. Now I would like to see another two songs combined together, and they're like love.
Okay.
An important element in your music is love, and it's what I like in these songs when I was a kid, and I even more like today. It's a love song, but it's not a sissy song, if you understand me. You know, like
thank you.
I don't like a love songs that the man is crying, like
yeah, come back, you know. But the truth is, men cry a lot.
Yeah, we do. You know, I cried also. You know. But I like to represent myself like this.
Yes.
Baby, come back. Right. No, it's kind of nice.
Me too.
Makes
That's
you a better man.
The song.
You know?
Yes.
And it was like, how did you make these beautiful love songs? You know, it's like you had a good love life.
Love. Social commentary. People are the themes of my songs. I write everything. I can write, if you ask me to write about a stone on the floor, I can do that. But the songs that you're listening to, these songs come to me through divine intervention. I don't know about other writers. I only know about me. I'll be walking down the road or driving in my car, and suddenly, zing! And that song is there, and it doesn't take long. You've just got to do it. It doesn't take long. Songs about love, equally as easy to write for me as social commentary.
Yeah. And the girls loved you because of your hair. Is it still under the hat?
Or? There's a lot of it. It's
getting
a little thinner, but it's getting longer.
It's getting longer, right. Yeah. And then how did you manage to struggle with all those girls? You know,
Is my wife looking?
Probably no, but you never know.
So she's not looking.
Yeah.
Well, girls, it's all right.
It's okay.
Yeah.
Not too many.
No, not too many. I don't do too much of anything.
But there is only one that you love.
Yes, that is the truth. Yes. I have a magnificent wife of 45 years. And she has made 4 beautiful children for me, who are no longer children, they're big people now.
Okay.
44, 43, you know, they're big people. But she is the rock on which I stand. My wife. Okay. And if you're watching, wherever you are,
you are the wife number one. And Danny, I want to ask you about your outfit, you know, because you look very cool, you know. I kind of like it.
You like this?
Yeah, I like it, yeah.
Hang on. You like this?
Yeah.
It's all right?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's very cool, isn't it? I'm not lying to you.
No, I know he's telling the truth.
Yeah. I always remember this if you come back again.
Yes.
I always stop lying in the 9th minute of the show.
Oh, good.
Yeah, so we're cool now, you know?
We're cool. Yeah. We're on good ground.
So where did you get those things, you know?
London.
Yeah.
Most of my clothes I buy and leave in London because in the Caribbean you don't need clothes.
Yeah.
You understand?
Nice, yeah, I understand.
So I buy my clothes, I leave them in London, and because of that, I have to stay trim.
Yeah.
Because if I have to come out like here now and the belly is.
But in the Caribbean, you don't get belly so easy. Huh?
Oh, yes, you do.
You do?
Yes, you do.
I don't know.
I know a lot of my friends who are like, you know, I have to go to the gym 3 times a week.
So you do? You go, yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, that explains everything. You know, I understand. I thought it's because of it's black, you know, but...
No. You're talking about my clothes. I'm talking about me.
Okay.
My body.
Okay. So before we do the commercial break, I need to ask you something, you know? I saw in these few days, you know, like you went to see the football club Partizan.
Ding!
Ding, yeah. And I want to make a small present for you, you know. And because this is the kind of thing, you know, you should have with yourself. You know that there is an opposite club from Partizan, Red Star, you know?
There must be a lot of opposite
clubs. Yeah.
Oh,
but
wow.
This is the, you know, and this is Eddie Grant at the back.
Oh,
in Cyrillic, it's our Serbian letter, you know? So I want to give you this, because maybe in the future you might change your mind about Partizan, you know?
Oh.
And start cheering for the right club, you know? Cela, dobij otkaz, brate.
My friend, trust me, he is not smart.
They know that. They know that. Looks nice. Come on. Looks nice.
It's lovely. It's like the United States flag.
It's similar. Yeah. No, come on.
Hold on a second. Hold on a second.
We don't have the stars and the blue things.
Oh, yeah. Something.
It's only the
stripes. I knew something was missing.
Yeah, we would never do, you know, the American flag.
No.
We'll do the short commercial break if it's okay with you.
Yes.
Because we need to earn some money, you know.
Oh, let's do that, man.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's earn some money. And my band will play some songs, so we'll hear them.
Thank you.
Ostanite sa nama, u drugom delu emisije razgovarat ćemo o tome šta Eddie Grant danas radi, gde živi, kako peca, i možda ga ubedim da počne da navija za Crvenu zvezdu. Zabavljava nas band danas, šta je da kada? Usually they play something faster, you know, but I'm a big fan of Elvis.
I think it was great. I've heard that you're a big fan of Elvis.
Yeah.
I hear you sing as well.
Oh, yeah, I'm singing like crazy. I just want you to.
I think that the band deserve a bigger round of applause.
Yeah, definitely. You know,
just
you know,
feel free.
I sing when they need to go out, you know, and the band is singing regularly. Molim sve velike aplauze.
Yes. They work hard.
They work hard, actually. Yes. Every week, you know, they play two songs in my show, so it's something like over than 300 songs until now. And they're not paid at all, you know. Oh. They don't get the money.
Oh.
You know, so it's like, you know, yeah. They just come here because they love me a lot.
I understand.
Yeah, because I'm a great guy. Actually.
You're back on the line again.
Yes, I am, because it's again the 9 minutes, you know, after the commercials. No, I'm joking. It's okay. Let's speak a little bit. You have a few passions. I heard that your passion is football. You like it, which is normal. And then you have this. A lot of friends that are fishing, and this is actually not your passion, but you're always with them, you know. It's... Or it is your passion.
No, I don't fish, really. I've got friends who are great fishermen, and from time to time, they try to get me to fish. I'm no good. But this one friend that has brought me here took me fishing in my country. Or it looks like I took him fishing in my country.
In your country, yeah.
He could not catch a fish. We were on the river for hours, and this guy has got really big reputation in this country, so I have to be very careful.
Careful.
The fish would not bite for him.
Why?
I don't know. But then all of a sudden, at about nearly 6 o'clock, it's getting dark. It gets dark very fast in the tropics. All of a sudden, he says, hold on. I am a great fisherman. I will show you. And he went, whoosh. And and it went, zzz. He said, I got it. And he started playing one big piranha.
No.
Like this. I said, marvelous. He says, but hold, one more. Another big piranha. I says, but the light's gone now. It's dark. He says, yeah, we can go home now. But the crocodiles are now in the water, and you can see their eyes.
Eyes. Wow.
This is not very nice.
It's freaky.
So you could tell he's not really a great fisherman.
Not really.
He only thinks so.
He only thinks
yes,
so.
Yes, but he's my friend.
Okay. If he's your friend, then he's a great fisherman.
I
have this policy with my friends, you know. If somebody's my friend, he's great in his job, number one in the world.
Well, then, my friend, is the greatest fisherman in the world.
In the world.
But I'll tell you after. I'll tell you after Saturday.
Okay.
Then he was playing away. On Saturday, he will be playing at home.
At home. Okay.
Then I will.
We'll
know.
See.
Yes.
Okay. So we have some clip from the fishing, if you agree to see it.
More fish?
Yeah.
Yes. And you're hurting, I'm the one who loves you when you're high. Who loves you when you're horny? I'm the one. Who loves you when you cry? I'm the one. Who loves you, babe, when it's heavy? I'm the one. They were big.
Yeah.
They look even bigger on the film, you know.
But it's a beautiful country. I didn't know it's so.
So beautiful. Guyana is a magnificent country. We are only 700,000 people in Guyana. We have more people in New York than we have in Guyana. So there's a lot of space. If you want to come on down to Guyana, come on down. Tell them Eddie said so.
Yeah, okay. Are you a big star there? They love you probably, yeah, of course. Yeah. You're like the god there. Huh? Yeah, okay, I'll say that. You don't have to say that.
Yeah.
It is okay. But nowadays you live in Barbados, yeah?
I've lived in Barbados for the last 30 years.
30 years?
Yes. And then the next question comes, well, why, with such a beautiful country, are you living in Barbados?
Oh, no, I won't ask you that, because I know Barbados is also nice.
It's, well, yes, but we are very close. We are called the Caribbean. Although we are in South America, yeah, we are included.
Included.
And so it's not so far away. So when I spoke to my president and I said, you know, things are very bad in Guyana right now. Telephones were bad then. You know, you couldn't transfer monies out to do business at the time, you know. And I said, look, I need to live in the Caribbean. He says, well, Barbados is all right. So I've lived in Barbados for 30 years with the blessing of my people in Guyana.
Yeah.
And now I'm building my home also in Guyana.
In Guyana.
Yes.
I think we have something from Barbados, so we can see how it looks like.
Go!
It's your home, yeah?
It's my home.
Yeah, I think I could manage there.
Yeah, you could manage.
Looks kind of nice. Looks kind of
yeah,
nice.
It's all right.
Do you? You have there a music studio, yeah?
And, yes.
You still work.
I'm working all the time, making music. We've played host to a number of guys. Sting, who was on your
yes.
program. We've played host to the Rolling Stones, Paul McCartney. We've had the Julio Iglesias, we've had just about everybody, Elvis Costello.
Yeah. Wow.
They've all been
great names. Yeah.
Roxy Music, Brian Ferry, yeah. these guys.
He was also on the show.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, I saw it on your show reel.
Promo, yeah.
Yeah. Nice guy.
Yeah, he. Yeah. Yeah.
They're all nice guys.
They're all nice guys.
Yes.
I didn't meet the others, you know, I just met Sting
the
and
Stones,
him.
The Stones, they're real good.
I think I wouldn't be able to speak with the Stones. You know?
No?
I don't know.
You would be.
I just want to ask you something.
Next is, it's all right. Just come on, talk to me, mate.
Tell me, I heard you do very good these interpretations, you know, like Pakistani people, Chinese people.
No. I do Mick Jagger sometimes, and that's what I was trying to do to you just now.
Okay,
so. I could say, oh, yeah, Ivan, yeah, look, it's all right. You can talk to me, you know what I mean? You don't have to worry about it. It's all right.
So I'll count this like I spoke with Mick Jagger, you know?
Exactly.
No.
You just spoke to Mick.
I can put it to my portfolio, you know? Like.
I have just, you can say, I've spoken to Mick.
Yeah. Thank you. But can you interpret Paul McCartney?
Very difficult. Paul McCartney is almost, when he's speaking like a Yankee, you know, everything's all right, you know. But the Liverpudlian accent is almost impossible for a boy from Guyana
to interpret. Yeah, I understand that. But you have many talents. Besides the music and everything, you did some TV shows like and great interviews. With Lech Walesa, if I'm right, yes.
And, yes, we did Lech Walesa, who was a great, great guy and a great humanitarian, and he received me with all the graces of a president. Yeah, he is a bit special.
Yeah, it goes there, you know. It's like we can speak, and it's how did you feel in this role? Because doing interviews. I mean, you said before the show, like, we'll just do the normal conversation,
yeah.
Which actually what this job is.
Yes.
But not so many people understand it. That's the only thing that they should do.
You know, talking to people is easy for me. It doesn't matter whether I can speak the language or not. I've been in situations where I'm talking to people that I don't know their language, and we have to get on somehow. I have to get through the country, or I've got to get wherever I want to get to without being able to speak the language.
I would like to speak to you about...
For me, what is the most interesting thing? You didn't do the interview with the musicians. You did it with the politician, and it's kind of different.
Because he's an important man. This really was a very serious thing for me, because I have an idea in my head about people, and whether you're a politician or whether you're a priest or who, and I have an idea in my head about you, then it's easy for me to speak to you. We are speaking like equals, you know. And Lech Walesa was really a special man. We went there, and his whole family was very good to us. And I was not meant to speak for a long time with him, because he's a very busy man. And he stayed there, and we had a really great time. We took a lot of photographs and stuff. Yes, I'm very happy that I met Lech Walesa.
Is there any person that you... any person that you wanted to do an interview with and you didn't manage? Or now, if somebody will come and tell you, Eddie, choose a person in the world to do an interview with, who would you choose?
Wow. I wanted to speak to Muhammad Ali very, very badly. And that obviously did not happen. Mm. In today's world, there are not that many people that I really would like, honestly, to talk to on a one-to-one, honestly, so that they would tell me the truth.
Yeah.
You see, there are a lot of people who are maybe politicians or leaders of churches or these kinds of things who you can talk to and you can have a fantastic discussion, but it would not be the truth.
Yeah.
So in looking for the truth, or even something looking like the truth, it's very, very difficult today. The world is really a very strange place today. I think I have to start writing again songs of social conscience.
Absolutely, and, I'm encouraging you about this. But is this the reason why would you speak with Muhammad Ali? Because you expect that he would say truth?
When a person has a life like that and he has to defend it, it's very, very difficult. Let me tell you, when somebody's shaking millions of dollars in front of your eyes and saying, be somebody else, Muhammad, be somebody else. And he says, I can't.
Yeah.
I just don't know how to. That's a fantastic, and that deserves a round of applause.
It is, yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I love, we came to the end of the show. We'll finish in about 4.5 minutes. And I always ask my guests, what do you do today? What are your hobbies, you know? How do you spend your free time? When you don't do music, do you enjoy with your family, or do you have some hobbies that you...
I play sport. I've played squash. I told you I had heart problems at 23.
He told me.
I learned to play squash at 34.
Oh.
It just goes to show.
The squash is
if somebody's looking at this show tonight and they're not well, just remember that I was sick at 23 and was about to give up, and I didn't give up. And today I am here, fit, strong, and able. It can happen for you.
Yeah, cool. Nice.
Ivan the Terrible. You've heard of this man?
Of course.
Ah,
it's my grandfather.
This is Ivan the Terrible. He did something to me tonight. And he laughed, and he's a guy, he's funny, he's got a great sense of humor.
Thank you very much.
You have a great sense of humor.
Thanks a lot.
Can I just take off my
jacket? Of course, yeah, sure.
It's a little hot in here. I don't know if I'm going to lose my microphone.
No, it's stick to your shirt.
Okay, it's a little hot. But can I? I mean,
yeah, you can do whatever you want. I'm sure that you know it's like
these. Oops. I dropped the microphone.
I think I know what you're going to do.
You don't know anything.
Oh, you absolutely have some part in
the
T-shirt or
something. You don't
know
anything.
Yeah, I know. So,
everything is all right?
Yeah.
That's all right.
I'm waiting for you.
That's fantastic. Fantastic. Thank you. So now, excuse me.
Yeah.
Since I've lived so long, this lifetime belongs here.
Okay.
The next lifetime belongs here.
Is that
good?
There is more than this. So I'll do something that I never did in my life. Yeah. I never did this in my life and in my career. Never, ever. I'll shake hands with somebody who's wearing a partisan.
Oh, my God, this is fantastic.
Yes. This is the only, in my life, this is the only picture like that, you know.
I feel like, who is the head of the United Nations?
Yeah, I don't know now.
I see that.
Ban Ki-moon, you know, something like that.
Ban Ki-moon. Yeah. I feel like Ban Ki-moon.
Yeah.
or maybe in my case, Kofi Annan.
Kofi Annan. I have luck because the president of the United Nations Parliament is a Serbian guy, Vuk Jeremic, so I can feel like a Serbian guy.
Oh, well, great.
It's below you, don't worry.
No problem. Yeah, yeah. No
okay.
problem.
We always finish this show with funny clips that the audience is sending to us. So if you agree, if we can see that, and then I will release you from this suffer that you had here.
I agree.
Thank you very much. Gledamo rubriku Stigla me pošta i krećemo naravno od mesta broj 5. So, you know, like, I mean, I never had a situation like this. It happened to me to get the wine or something like that, but the food never, you know. Gledamo mesto broj 4.
Ooh, piece of candy. Ooh, piece of candy. Ooh, piece of candy. Ooh, piece of candy.
Gledamo mesto broj 3. That's very short. Skip there. Kind of expectable. Mesto broj 2.
Let me show you how to swing. Look.
That they will show you, you know? You need to do it with the legs first, you know? I mesto broj 1. Povinjački video je poslao Zdravko Batinić iz Beograda i on je dobio Maserati sat, ali Zdravko nije došao večeras, tako da će Bane doneti odluku da pokloni nekome sat. Izvolite. Samo vidi da bude muško. Ozbiljno, a? To je nešto ozbiljno između vas ili... Yeah. You see what they do, you know, the best one gets the watch, but he didn't come tonight.
Oh, I see.
And Bane decided to give a watch to a guy. And never mind, you know. I don't want to think about it.
No, me too.
So we came to the end, and you said about the spectacular people that you wanted to meet and to do the interviews with, and if I would make my list of 10 all around the world, you're definitely on the list. So this tonight was like a dream came true for me, and I'm very, very happy that I met you, and I'm even happier that you're such a cool person, because sometimes you disappoint yourself about your idols, you know.
Thank you very
And I'm
much.
Glad that I didn't disappoint myself. Thank you very much for being
Thank
my
you
guest.
Very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Sledeća petka, 21:15 na televiziji Prva, već s Jenom Ivanovićem. Hvala, lako noć. Thank you.